Greetings from Talent Battle. Hello everyone, I'm Rohit from Talent Battle. Welcome to our new video. In this video, we are going to solve the previous year's pseudocode questions for Capgemini Drive. This video will help you to prepare for the same. Also, you can join our masterclass training where we can cover all the previous year questions, and also join our social media handles like Telegram groups, Instagram page, WhatsApp groups. We are constantly updating the placement preparation updates and off-campus updates too. Links to all these social media handles are given in the video description. So before we start, don't forget to subscribe our YouTube channel and press the bell icon for instant notification about our videos. Now in this video, we will discuss about the Capgemini pseudocode MCQ. The analysis, if you take into the consideration, that in the Capgemini pseudocode MCQ round, we will be having two sections. The data structure section will consist of 10 questions, and algorithmic sections programming part will consist of 15 questions. So the important topics on the basis of previous year analysis, you can say that these are the some important topics. If you prepare accordingly with the help of these analysis, it will help you to solve the questions related to these concepts. So when it comes to data structures, you have to deal with 10 questions. So array, time complexity, then trees, linked list, stacks, queues, hashing, graphs, and etc. These are the important points. So mostly you can say that the basic fundamental information about all these data structures and their working mechanism, if you understand this conceptual understanding of this concept, then you can easily solve those questions related to the data structures, where 10 questions you have to solve. Whereas in the algorithmic part, 15 questions you have to do, and the important points that will help you to solve these questions will be basic understanding of programming logic, because pseudocode will be there, which is an informal language. So you have to understand the logical flow of that respective given statements. After that, basic fundamentals with input and output conditions, object-oriented programming concepts, operators, flow control mechanism, looping statements. If you properly analyze all these topics and practice accordingly, easily you can solve the questions related to this. So this was the analysis. You prefer this analysis and easily you can solve the questions, right? So let's move on to the actual contents. So this is the first question. So read it carefully. Predict the output of the following. So they have provided some pseudocode statements here, so which is an informal language, and once you analyze the step-by-step logic that how actually it is going to work, then easily you can solve the questions related to this. So what is given here? Integer ABC, three integer values are given, right? Say for example, we take it like this, A, that is my integer value, B, and then C. And they have also provided us the initialization part also, that set A is equals to 108, B is equals to 2, and C is equals to 3, right? So we have done with this. Then see, if block is there, this much is my if block and this much is my else block. So depending upon this condition, what they have mentioned here, this statement will be executed, B is equals to B plus A mod of 2, otherwise else block will be executed. So we have to cross check based on the condition results, right? So what is the condition? A mod 9 equals 0. So this condition is actually written like this. If A mod of 9 is equals to 0, then this particular two statements will be executed. And then if this condition is true, else block will not execute. So we will be skipping this part. So depending upon the result of this condition, that will be decided. Otherwise, if this condition is false, then else block will be executed and you have to deal with these two cases. C is equals to C plus A mod of 7 and printing the value of C, right? And the note is also given that mod means this particular functionality will find the remainder after the division of the number. So you have to take this into account and according to that you have to calculate the cases. Now A is 108, so our condition will be 108 mod of 9 equals to 0. Now if you check that easily we can have the division of 108 by 9. So my remainder value will be 0. So this will result into the true part, this condition, and then we have to execute these two statements now. So else block will not execute, if block will be only executing. So calculate B. So B is equals to B plus, again we have a condition A mod of 2. So what is B? 2 plus A. What is A here again? 108 mod of 2. Now again 108 mod of 2 will result into the total division, because we have to deal with the remainder part, and that is 0. So my final answer will leads to B is equals to 2, right? 2 plus 0, that is equals to 2. So option A is the correct option for this, because we are printing B here and B will be getting printed. So final output result will be 2. So for this question, option A is the correct answer. Let's move on to the next question. What is the output of the following pseudocode, right? So they have provided again some pseudocode and they are expecting the output for this. So let us try one by one statement. Integer A, so we have a normal integer value A. Then string str1, so we have a string type object, that is str1. And they have set the value for str1 is equals to MOMO, right? So str1 is equals to MOMO. And for each A from 1 to 2. Now how to analyze these cases? On the basis of given, so this is a looping statement. On the basis of given this value, we have to identify that how many times this loop will work. So basically if you go with the ending condition, easily you will come to know that this loop will execute 2 times, right? Because it is ranging from 1 to 2 for the value of A, right? So 2 times it will execute. And what is written inside the loop? str1 is equals to str1 plus mm. So you are concatenating with the string here. So first time when it will be executed, so my string 1 is calculated for first iteration. You can say str1 current value is MOMO plus it is concatenated with double M. So it will be becoming MOMOMM, right? This will be for the first iteration. Then again, second time it will be iterate. Second iteration, again you are calculating the value of new string. So what is the current updated value? That is MOMOMM. And plus again, you are concatenating it with the new case, that is MM. So now you can have the final result related to this will be like this. So this will be my updated case of str1, MOMO, then 2 times M, again 2 times M, because my iterations are working in 2 cases. And after this for loop is totally executed, this is my updated result of str1. After that I am trying to print the length of str1. String length means this is a functionality which will give me the length of str1. So what is the length here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So length part will be equals to 8 here. So what is my final output in this case? Option D, that length of that respective string will be 8. So in this way you have to analyze the pseudocode given statements, and on the basis of looping conditions check that how many times it will execute, and accordingly the further variables and the statements which are written inside the loop will be updated, and according to that final result will be calculated. The next question, what would be the output of the following pseudocode here? So let us go one by one. Integer A is there, normal variable. Then we have one more str1 here again, which is equals to, they have asked us to set the value of str1 is equals to GOOSE. So GOOSE, this is the value that has been set for str1, and they are calculating A here. A is equals to what? String length of str1. So what is the length of this str1? 5, because it consists of 5 characters. So A becomes 5 here, right? But they are not printing A, they are printing A exclusive. See, this is bitwise XOR operator, right? A exclusive, bitwise exclusive, you can say, OR, right? Bitwise exclusive OR with 1. So what is the value of A? That is 5 and 1. So what they are expecting actually? 5 XOR with 1. What is the result of this operation? That will be our final answer in that case, right? Now we need to have certain information about this operation, right? Bitwise XOR, because the symbol that they have used here, that is corresponding to the bitwise XOR. So bitwise XOR. Now as we know, that bitwise XOR operator will compare each bit, right? So if I represent 5 into the binary terms, so it will be like 0101, right? And if I represent 1 into the binary terms, it will be 001. So I am trying to perform the bitwise XOR operations on these cases, 001. Now, as we know, in the case of XOR operation, the comparison of every bit for its first operand and the corresponding equal second operand, right? These two are the operand in my case, 5 and 1. So if both the bits are same, it will result into the 0. And if the bits are not matching, then it results into the 1. So what is the conversion of this? That is 4. Right? So 5 XOR 1, that results out to be 4. So option B is my current case value. Now, mostly in some questions, it might happen that this operator can be taken as a power off. But mostly in pseudocode questions, if they are utilizing symbol here like this, because we used to represent power also with the help of this particular symbol. But mostly in pseudocode, if they are utilizing this, it is mostly bitwise XOR operation. Bitwise operators are used, right? So make sure that you are analyzing the question properly, and on the account of that, you solve it. So final answer for this question will be option B, that is 4. Then next question, what will be the output of the provided pseudocode? So here 4 variables they have provided, I, J, K, N, N. So analyze one by one. All of them are of integer type. So I is there. Right now we don't know the value of I because it is not provided. Then J is also there, K and N, right? After second step, we got an idea that J is equals to 1 and K is equals to 1. So J is 1 and K is also 1. And now there is a for loop for each I from 1 to 5. So 1 to 5 you have to traverse in this respective for loop for the value of I. Say for example, I is equals to 1, then what you are going to perform? So these are the statements that you will be performing inside the for loop. So let us analyze. For such questions, it is very easy to identify the output, because after one or two iterations you will get a proper pattern of the output, and easily you can save the time by clicking that option. So if for example for I is equals to 1, in that case first time my loop will execute. So what will be the output in this case? First statement is printing K. What is the current value of K? 1. So we will be printing 1. So it means that my first output will be 1. So my first option, which is starting from 2, that is got discarded. Now we have only 3 options, and out of that we have to choose any one. After that J is calculated, J is equals to J plus 1. So J is equals to J plus 1. So what is the current value of J? 1 plus 1, that will become 2. So J becomes 2, right? Here, after I am talking about first iteration when I is equals to 1, then K is calculated. K is equals to K plus J. So what is the current value of K? We have 1. What is the J we have calculated? That is 2. So it becomes 3. So K is equals to 3. So when my first iteration is completed for these 3 instructions, 1 is printed on the output screen and J and K are calculated, that is 2 and 3. So when I was equals to 1, I got J is equals to 2 and K is equals to 3. These are updated values, and on the output screen I am having 1. Then again I will become 2, because for 1 to 5 we have to prepare. So again, when I is equals to 2, let us again do it same. Print the first statement, that is K. What is the current value of K? That is 3. So 3 will be printed here. Then again you calculate J. J is equals to J. What is the latest value of J? 2 plus 1. So it will become 3. So J will become 3. After that, K is equals to K plus J. What is the latest value of K? 3 plus latest value of J, that is 3. So K is equals to 6. So when I was 2, I got J and K as 3 and 6, right? So my next iteration, J becomes 3 and K becomes 6. And again, I am printing it. So I will get 6 here. Now, if you follow the pattern, as we can save the time by not going further solving this case, because up to 5, it will go in the same case. And you can see the pattern. First 1 will be printed, then 3 will be printed, then 6 will be printed. So option B is matching with the pattern that we are receiving by this process, right? So option B is the correct answer for this particular question. So you just analyze how for loop works and whatever the statements which are given inside that for loop, that will be working. Then next question, What will be the output of the following pseudocode? We have three integers provided, A, B and C, and we have certain values also. So B is equals to 10, that is provided, and A is equals to 1. If 0, so what is the meaning of this? When you pass 0, it is treated as a false part. Means this condition will not work and it will pass my control to the else block. And what is written in the else block? Three statements are there. So execute all these three statements sequentially and then we'll try to print the value of A. So what is A on the basis of current information we have? A is equals to B plus 1. What is the value of B? That is 10 plus 1, that becomes 11. So updated value of A is 11 now. Then we calculate B. B is equals to A minus 1. What is A? 11. So I will be utilizing this value here. 11 minus 1, that becomes 10. So my B becomes 10 here. And then again I am calculating A. A is equals to A. What is updated value of A? 11 again. 11 minus 1, that is 10. So final A I got 10. B is also 10, updated value. Right? And what I am printing after this? Now it is not a loop, it is a conditional statement only. So one time it will execute and then I am printing the value of A. What is the latest value of A that I am getting? That is 10. So option C is the correct answer for this question. Then, as I told you that there will be certain questions from data structures also. So we have included some questions of pseudocode and some questions of data structures here. So now this is related to the data structure. See, binary search tree. So what is the question? In an empty binary search tree, insert the following elements in a similar sequence. So same sequence we have to follow. And which element will be at the lowest level? This is our expected question, that we have to identify the element which will be at lowest level. Now to solve this question, you need to have the knowledge that how BST is formed. Binary search tree means what? It is a part of binary tree where we used to put the elements which are smaller than the root element, right? Root element, smaller elements will be on the left hand side, left side, smaller than the root, and greater elements which are than the root will be on the right hand side. So we will be applying this logic to implement this particular BST and then we will get the element which is at lowest level. So sequentially they have mentioned similar sequence you have to follow. So take first element as a root. So 105 as my root element. Now this is my root. Right. Then next element is 95, so I will be comparing here 95 with 105. 95 is smaller than 105, so I will be putting it on the left hand side. So it goes to the left hand side, that is 95. Next is 122, again I will compare it with 105. It is greater than 105, so it will be on the right hand side. So that is 122. So in this way we will be applying it recursively for all the elements and then we will get the answer. Next element is, so 105 is done, 95 is done, 122 is done. Next is 99. So compare 105 and 99. 99 is smaller, so it will come on the left hand side. Again we have one more element here. Again compare 99 and 95. So 99 is greater than 95, so it will be on the right hand side. You go here, 99 will be placed at this position. Then next element is 97. Compare it with 105 again. So every time I am comparing it with the root elements, then next level, like this. So 97 and 105 is compared. 97 is smaller, so we have to go into the left hand side. Again compare with 95. 97 is greater than 95, so go into the right hand side. Again we have 99 and comparison with 97. 97 is smaller than 99, so 97 will be here. And then 120. Compare 105 with 120. 120 is greater, so go on the right hand side. 122 and 120 will be compared. 120 is smaller than 122, so you can put it on the left hand side. So all the elements are being checked and my tree structure forms like this. So this is my root element, this is my left child of the root, this is my right child of the root, this is right of left child, this is left of right child, and this will be my last element. Now you go level by level, level 1, level 2, level 3 and level 4. So what was the question? Which element will be at the lowest level? See, the element 97 has occurred at the lowest level. So my option C is the correct answer for this question. So if you know the idea how BST works and what kind of rules we have to follow while forming the BST, easily you can solve this type of question, right? Moving towards the next question. Which of the following statements are true about Floyd's cycle finding algorithm. So this cycle finding algorithm is nothing but a loop detection algorithm in the linked list. If you have the knowledge about the Floyd's cycle finding algorithm, that how it works, easily you can solve this question, because the main agenda behind this algorithm is to identify the loop if it is present in the linked list. So what we do in this algorithm, we maintain a slow pointer and a fast pointer, where slow pointer changes one position and fast pointer changes position by two. And after performing certain iteration, we check whether they are coinciding with the same linked list node or not. If yes, then means there is a loop in the linked list, otherwise no. So this is the main reason for utilizing this algorithm. So cycle finding means loop detection. Now, which of the following statements are true? Map this agenda with the provided options. It is used to reverse the linked list? No. It is used to detect the loop in the linked list. To remove the duplicates? No. And none of the mention is no. So option B is correct option, that we are going to detect the loop in the linked list with the help of this. So it is also called as loop detection algorithm or Floyd's cycle finding algorithm also. So you need to have the knowledge about how it works and what is the purpose behind that, so that easily you can solve this. So theoretical stuff is there. Then next question, what do you mean by underflow condition with respect to what? Stack. So stack data structure knowledge is required here. And what is underflow? As we know, with respect to the stack, you can perform push operation and pop operation. Push operation means what? You will insert an element, one element at a time. And pop operation means you will remove that. And the working mechanism will be first in, last out, right? Or last in, first out, you can say. So what is the reason for underflow condition? Underflow means what? Suppose my stack is empty, right? There are no elements. Means my top reference is pointing to minus one, you can say. And still I am trying to perform the pop operation. This type of scenario is called as underflow condition, right? When I am trying to remove the element from the stack, there are no elements in the stack. In that scenario, that is called as an underflow condition. So which question option is matching here? It is when the stack is completely filled? No. It is when the stack is empty? Yes. And we try to push? No. When the stack is empty, when we perform pop operation, then the underflow condition is there. So it is when stack is completely filled. So completely filled options are discarded first, and then empty. So stack is empty, stack is empty. Here push operation is there, here pop operation is there. So we are expecting pop, because we have to deal with underflow. So option D is the correct answer here, that when the stack is empty and still we are trying to remove the elements, no elements are there, still you are trying to remove it, that is called as an underflow condition. What will be overflow in that case? That if my stack is full as per the capacity and still I am trying to push it, that will be overflow, right? But here it was asked about underflow. So stack is empty and still you are trying to perform the popping operation, then that will leads to be underflow condition. Moving towards the next question. Consider an array A, right? So A array is given 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 elements are there. So value of n is equals to 7 here. And a key which is equals to 10, right? So key value is also given, that is equals to 10. Now how many comparisons would be done to find the key element in the array using the binary search? Okay, so they have also provided with the algorithm that binary search. Now the little bit information about the binary search will help you to solve this question. And what they have asked, number of comparisons. So options are 5, 1, 2 and 3. Okay. So how binary search works? So as we know that binary search prerequisite requirement for searching a particular element with the help of binary search is my array should be in a sorted manner. Already the element should be in sorted manner, and then we perform the division part of that. We calculate the mid value, we divide the array, right? We divide the array. So we can say that we are performing n by 2 case. N is the total number of elements and we are performing n by 2 case by dividing the array, and then we look for the element that I am searching for. So that is key element. So on the basis of mid value, if my key element is less than the mid value, I will be looking into the left portion of the array. That is my first division. If the value that I am searching is greater than the mid value, I will be looking in the right portion of the array. That is second division. Means the basic idea behind this is division. Now, how I can identify that number of comparisons, right? So as we know that in binary search, it will take the complexity of searching will take log n to the base 2, right? This will be the complexity part. So to search a particular element using binary search with this logic that the array is already in a sorted manner, that is requisite. After that, we will divide it by half and then we will compare it with the mid value and then we will decide whether to go with left hand side or right hand side. So that will be the case of log n base 2 for searching a particular element. Now, as the problem is divided into n by 2 every time and it will goes on searching till your searching process stops. So again, you will repeat this process recursively, right? So on the account of that recursiveness, so if we apply recursive functionality here or recursive formula that we are utilizing on the basis of n by 2, so the equation of that recursiveness will be like this. T of n, total time taken by T of n by 2, that I am dividing it plus 1. So my n by 2 raised to k is equals to 1, right? This will be the simplification part of that. Now you can take log on both the sides as we are trying to calculate the number of comparisons. So as this is the searching case, na, complexity part, log of n. So taking log on both the sides, it will give me log of n is equals to log of 2 raised to k. Then substitute the values after simplification. Log of n is equals to k log 2. As I know that k is equals to log n base 2. See, I have told you that it will be an log n base 2 for searching in a binary, for binary search in an array. So we have simplified that equation in such a manner that k is equals to log n base 2. Now we have the value of n here, total number of elements in the array, that is 7. So after substituting this value, you will get k is equals to log 7 base 2. So log 7 base 2 will be 3, right? So k is equals to 3. So my answer will be 3 comparisons. How many comparisons? 3 comparisons we will be requiring to perform the element searching of a binary search. So if you know this part, log of n base 2, easily you can directly solve this question. But to understand why it is log of n, this much amount of information is mandatory in that case, right? So moving towards the next question. Now, for which of the following applications can you use hashing, right? So what is hashing now? So we have a key value data, right? Key value data is maintained. And in terms of hashing, we have an hash function which generates some hashing value, which is utilized to store the data on a unique basis, identity basis, right? But what is the application of this in real life? So you have to analyze these three options which are provided and try to map that this concept of hashing is applicable where. So first option is to construct a message using authentication code. So now authentication code will be unique. And that is what hashing does. It generates a unique identity or index value on which we can store the data. So we can have the application of hashing here also. For timestamping, which is also a unique one, right? So this is also possible application on the basis of hashing. And for detecting a cycle in a graph. So for detecting cycle in a graph, uniqueness is not there. We don't need any application of hashing over here for detecting a cycle, right? So this is not relatable to this respective application of hashing. So option 1 and 2 means statement number 1 and statement number 2, both are the applications of hashing. You can utilize hashing for message authentication, generation and as well as timestamping. So choose the correct answer. Only 1 and 2. So option D is the correct answer for this particular question, right? So I hope you got the idea about all the pseudocode questions as well as the algorithmic questions related to the data structures. So don't forget to subscribe our YouTube channel and thank you for watching this video.